CTO, partner, development lead. We build software. How we WordPress is we build e-commerce software. Some of you in the WooCommerce space, can everybody hear me all right? Am I good? Yes? Okay. In the WooCommerce space, you may know us for our affiliate WP plugin, which integrates with WooCommerce to run your affiliate program. So that's kind of how we WordPress is by building e-commerce software. How I like my bagels? I don't really care how it's cut. I'm pretty much not even particular about what kind of bagel, as long as I get to eat it, because I like carbs. Tonight we're going to talk a little bit about, I was going to run an A/B test on you guys. We're going to talk about A/B testing. It's funny that there's so many people here that like just finding out about WordPress, people who do .NET, I used to do .NET development too, so I somehow ended up in this space. A/B testing is interesting. So we'll start with a really quick thing. You might see like a call to action on the web page, introduction to A/B testing, sign up now. And then you might have another version that's like, hey, how to make the smartest person in the room look really dumb. Sign up for our A/B testing ebook. This is a quote that, I forget who said it, but it is one of my favorite quotes about A/B testing, is that it really makes people who sound very smart look kind of dumb sometimes. And that's because we're using data to make decisions rather than feeling. And that's really the key. So we're going to kind of go like, what actually is A/B testing? A/B testing at its long form, using statistics to confirm a positive bias towards one of two presented versions or more, but usually it's one or two, of content with a single variation. So in short, really, we're just going to use data to tell us how to convert our sites, our call to actions, anything. So we'll talk about things you can convert later. One of the specific things is that A/B tests are usually deliberately simple. You're not making massive changes in an A/B test, usually. You're making small iterative changes. You are focused on a single change instead of, oh, cool.
Working?
Hey, all right. Not off the screen. Thank you. We're focusing on a single change instead of multiple changes to an area. And obviously, these are, your mileage may vary. You may have a small change here or there that goes against the single small change, but in practice, it's better to test smaller focus changes than larger big changes. It doesn't have to be a small change, and it's isolated to a single test, so you're not running multiple tests on the same page at the same time. So what A/B testing isn't is making changes based off feelings. That's the whole point of using A/B testing, is so that we're not saying like, well, and I'm sure we've all heard this, I want it to pop, right? I like the color green more than I like the color blue. Okay, blue converts better than green in some cases. Why would you choose a color that doesn't convert better? So you're not making changes based on feeling, off preference, you're making them off data. You don't vote on changes. How many times have you had people, you know, three or four people in the room, all right, we've got two changes. Who likes A? Who likes B? More people chose B, we're gonna go with B. That's what we don't do with A/B testing. Testing more than one change on the same page at the same time. This one we'll get into a little bit later, but it basically creates a situation where you actually don't know if your change helped. I think the biggest misconception you have when you hear A/B testing is because it's in the name. You're not actually comparing A versus B. The goal is actually to use the results of which variation performs better to statistically guess or statistically choose what's going to convert better in the future. We're using visitors included in the test to help determine how it will convert. So let's say we include 1,000 people in our test. Usually you need way more than 1,000, but it's an easy round number. If you include 1,000 people in the test and variation A converts 400, and like 200, and variation B converts 400, you can guess and statistically state that if we take that 1,000 and change it to 100,000, that we're gonna have a 10 to 20% better chance to convert. So we're not really using it for just that one data set, it's really to extract it. You know, the census goes to everyone in the United States because you need a large sample size to make statistical decisions. The goal of A/B testing is to get that statistical significance, not to just look at a single number. So we'll get into statistical significance later because it's super important. So The really hard part about A/B testing is sometimes those results can take an extremely long time to show themselves. And this is kind of something that goes into a process called statistical winners, using data to prove what does work and what doesn't work. We've had a test take 6 weeks. We had a test take 3 months to actually give us a statistical winner. We had a test take 14 days. I'm going to talk about that one here soon. And it's fascinating, depending on the change you make, depending on the amount of traffic to the test, depending on other variations, it can take a long time for this to happen. And I think the biggest thing that you run into with A/B testing is a lot of people look at a single number. Variation A produced $10,000 in revenue. Variation B produced $20,000 in revenue. B's got to win, right? It's not always the case. If you purely look at a single number, we are going to cloud the rest of the data behind it. Things like the conversion rate. Sure, it generated $20,000, but the conversion rate on the one that produced less revenue could have had a whole 1% change. So it produced $10,000 more, but that 1% change could actually end up as more money. Things like, I'll get into one later about your product pricing makes a big difference when you look at the numbers. So let's take a look at a really interesting thing we ran into. We had variation A and B. A is our control. This was what the website currently looked like. Variation B was a change we wanted to implement. Variation A, the control, had these stats. So you can see it generated a decent amount of revenue. Visitors were about 12,000. Variation B got very close to the same number of visitors. Those are statistically insignificant, being 400 visitors apart. So the first thing people say is, well, I got less visitors. So of course, won or lost. Doesn't matter. It takes way more into account for that. It produced less revenue, but really not by much. Was it $1,500? $1,300 less? It took 50 less transactions. That's got to be the problem. It had a lower conversion rate, so that definitely didn't matter. But it did have a higher value per session. So is that better? The trick here is we sell a product that costs $499, one that costs $299, $199. You can see how, even though it was 50 transactions shorter, three sales of our most expensive product can make up the difference in the revenue. You can't just look at revenue numbers, you can't just look at conversion numbers. You have to kind of take everything into the picture. This test actually gave no clear winner, according to, we use Google Optimize to do this. So if we look at things, sure, there's a lot of green on variation A, and there's a lot of like yellowish on variation B, but because of the factors of product that costs a lot and can change the results with three transactions, the fact that the conversion rate is only 0.3% different, they found no winner. The test here was adding a continue shopping to the checkout function. We offer multiple products. A lot of people would instantly think that, well, continue shopping is going to bring your revenue up. Not always true. So A/B testing that kind of stuff, where you think it's a no-brainer, is something you should definitely think about. Some things that can kind of salt these. Are you running a sale while you're also running an A/B test? That will definitely ruin your results. And it may give you a winner, but did they purchase because it's on sale? Or did they purchase because your A/B test was better? Traffic anomalies. You got listed on Forbes or listed on the best 100 companies in Phoenix. You're going to take an influx of traffic. Because you just gained trust as being listed on Forbes.com, people see your link on Forbes.com or Business Insider, they're going to come to you and know that Business Insider linked to you. You've now built trust. So did you gain that sale because you now had a new level of being a subject matter expert, or did you get it because you had a good A/B test? We don't know. So keeping these things in mind when you're kind of looking at the unit as your A/B tests, your product prices, as I said earlier, with three purchases of our most expensive plan, we can basically remove any significance in the revenue numbers. It can swing us $1,500 with three purchases. So you have to look past revenue only. Are you running other A/B tests within your funnel? You know, if it takes three clicks to get to the final completion of your goal, if you're running an A/B test anywhere else inside that funnel, it can not necessarily ruin, but you have to take that into consideration if it affects your test results. So let's take a look at a good test. This was, looking back, stupid for us not to do this, but hindsight's 2020. So this was our menu. We sell add-ons, kind of like e-commerce does, where we have our main product is free and then we have a bunch of add-ons. So the link that says add-ons took you to the product listing. We had purchase options, which took you kind of like explaining our pricing, and then to go to your shopping cart. We made one change. We added a view all. Now, the view all goes to the same place as clicking on add-ons. This was stupid. We had three goals for this test. One of them, and this is, I think, important, we didn't use revenue as the primary goal. Because that isn't the primary goal. The primary goal was who visited the target URL. How many people did we get to go to the page that does all product listings? So revenue wasn't our main goal. It was a great side effect, but it wasn't the main goal. The number two is the number of transactions. Did we get more people to actually complete the purchase? And revenue was number three. So we're going to talk about these 95th, 50th medians. We saw a pretty significant increase in the number of people, almost 1.5%. That's significant. Conversion rate went up 0.6%, which doesn't sound like a lot, but when you're talking 20,000, 30,000 visitors, that's significant. Revenue per session nearly doubled. And session isn't necessarily purchases, that's just visits to the site. And I think the biggest one is it produced double the revenue. So how long were we out that much money? This was the test that ran for 14 days. Within 14 days, Google Optimize said, that's your winner, go with it. It had achieved enough data to pick a winner in 14 days. Sometimes tests take weeks or months. Yeah, clear winner was found this time and it was very expensive to not have that on there for a long time. So it's as simple as adding a small link. One link basically doubled our revenue for that. So thinking back to it, we have view all, we've got pricing, we've got the checkout. We also have a set of popular. Like how many times do you see like view popular products? Amazon does it, things being purchased now. We're like, cool, let's add another thing there that can help you add trust. These are the products people love. 6 weeks later, we didn't even have a clear win. So just because it works once, doesn't mean you can just throw more in there and get more. But if we would have just thrown popular in there, we would have just had it in there with no real result and not known if it made a difference. So keeping an eye on things and always testing things like that instead of just doing it. I like to point out like something that if you're making an A/B test and the control is, let's say, generating $1,000 a month and converting 50% of the time, if you split it down the middle, 50% of traffic gets control, 50% gets the test. If you make the change without testing, and it hurts revenue, you hurt revenue for every visitor. If you make the change for 50% of the traffic, and it hurts revenue, you've only hurt revenue for 50% of the traffic. If it improves revenue for 50% of the traffic, you're still up from the control, so then you can make the change longer. So it's always better to test, because it's better to test and know that you were right, or find out you were wrong on half your traffic than it is on all your traffic. So how about we take a look at a test? This one came from, anyone play SimCity? So SimCity, run by EA Games. There was a pre-order for SimCity 5. This was a really interesting one. So if you log in, you want to pre-order SimCity 5, you get $20 off your next EA Games purchase. That sounds pretty cool. These games are like $60. So that takes, you know, a third of your price off right away. This might seem like a no-brainer. Yeah, we're gonna get pre-orders. We haven't even released the game yet. We're taking in all this money, and all we're gonna do is give up $20 on their next purchase. So it makes sense. From a number standpoint, from a conversion standpoint, let's get the pre-orders, let's give them a discount, no big deal, we get the cost later. And plus there's a huge profit margin in games. So the variation they ran was, let's not show the $20 voucher for pre-order. Who thinks $20 enticed more people to pre-order? Raise your hand. Who thinks removing the $20 pre-order was better.
I think it's available now.
Well, so it wasn't for, the $20 wasn't for, yeah, right, so you think it's available now. Here's the funny thing. Not showing the $20 the $20 value for pre-ordering converted 40% better. 40%. That's $60 a pop. Yeah, that's money in your pocket there. So it's not something that you can always rely on. If you make assumptions about your target audience, you'll eventually be wrong. Eventually. I'm not saying always, but you eventually will be wrong in some ways. Their assumption was that people who pre-order SimCity 5 like games. Well, does anyone know what EA Games' main market is? Sports games. They do the FIFA, they do the NBA, they do all those sports games. People who play SimCity don't necessarily play sports games. Now some do, some don't. But they were relying on the fact that their customer was just going to buy more game. And clearly that was wrong. If we go back to the results of one of our tests, I mentioned this 95th, 50th median. So this is kind of a target graph. This doesn't have the 50th in it, but it does have the 95th. Who knows the term outliers when it comes to data sets, when you're dealing with outliers? You have to assume that 2.5% on the one end and 2.5% on the other end, you can toss out their data. There are anomalies in the data set usually. You got this bell curve, and you can kind of cut off the bell curve and just take the mean, and that's the 95%. The 50th even brings it in closer, and then the median is kind of right in the middle. So this kind of gives a really good explanation. This Conversion Sciences website, if you really want to get into A/B testing, Conversion Sciences is really cool. A lot of good data, a lot of great blog posts, and I think they have great graphics. I got a lot of data from them when I was learning about A/B testing. So it's kind of an interesting concept, but what it all comes down to is this concept of what's called a null hypothesis. It's kind of a weird, hard thing to explain, so I'll break it down fairly simply. The null hypothesis is basically, you need to assume that your control is the winner from the start. Your control is the winner because it's currently producing data for you, so you know the results of your control. Your variation is the wild card. So the whole goal here is to disprove that the null hypothesis is true by making your variation win, or failing to prove or disprove the null variation or the null hypothesis. The null hypothesis being, this change will make no difference. So it's the concept that we have in the justice system of you're innocent until proven guilty. Your control is the best one until it's proven that it's not. So that's kind of like the idea of why we do A/B testing. So I mentioned the statistical significance before, so we're going to talk a little bit about that. When I first started learning about A/B testing, I was like, what? I don't understand what statistical significance is. Money is money. Conversion rate is conversion rate. Traffic's traffic. Numbers don't lie. Numbers do lie, and you look at them like, don't look at them. So imagine running an AA test. This is going to sound really stupid for a minute, but there it is. Let's say you take 100 people, put them in a room, tell them to look at your website, and go through the purchase process. You take another 100 people and do the exact same website, with zero changes. Odds are, one of those groups is going to be considered a winner and convert better. It's kind of like doing the control and the, what's the term? Placebo effect. Like, you're going to have cases where changes don't even need to be made for you to see a difference. That could be a varying number of things. People have different brains, people have different vision, people have different focus, people read better, don't read better, all those things. Tendencies to one color versus another as far as like button color or text font or text size. All these things can make a difference in that. So essentially, the significance we get out of it is to go back to that 95, 50th median, is to cut out those weird anomalies of the testing subjects. So that's what we use is this confidence interval. We cut out possible anomalies. So one of the things that I always get asked is, well, what kind of things do you test? Because we do e-commerce, we sell and run our own e-commerce stores, what do we test? There's a common misconception you test everything, and they're not necessarily wrong, but I kind of go with you really shouldn't test all the things. Let's focus on things that are going to earn you the best return on your time. when I started doing the A/B testing, I had the same concept. We're going to test everything. Test everything we can on the site. Until I realized we had a test that ran for 3 months, and we got no data out of it. That's a waste of time, because we couldn't run any other tests on that page for 3 months, because we were waiting for another test to complete. So I really like to focus on kind of like the following things. And I think if you're going to take a takeaway and you want to start A/B testing, I think these are probably your biggest. Focus on your high traffic pages. Obviously, they're gaining traffic, whether they're high up in the Google results, they are linked somewhere, or they're just kind of like your homepage. Like it says, you're going to get a statistical winner faster off a high traffic page, and you're going to spend less time waiting for results to come in, as long as there's a lot of people visiting your page. So focus on your high traffic pages first. If you don't have Google Analytics, get it now, or some other analytics. Test up your funnel. We made the mistake once of running a test on the checkout page because we were like, well, let's see, we should be converting more. We should have people who reach checkout converting more. The issue wasn't with the checkout, it was with getting the checkout. So let's say you have three steps in your funnel process. Whether you're signing up email addresses, your goal is to get people on your mailing list, or selling a product, or just to simply get them to visit a specific page of your site. If 80% of your traffic goes from, you know, the first page to the second page, and then 40% of your traffic makes it to page three, and then 10% convert, we should be testing the conversion on page three. If 10% of your traffic makes it to page two of your process, you don't need to test anything on page two, you need to test page one. So just because your conversion rate is low, check your data, check your traffic, to make sure that the reason your conversion rate or your checkout rate is low, or your email address, or your email list isn't gaining subscribers at a rate you think is good, don't test the button to sign up for your email campaign. Test what got them to that point first, if your traffic is low or high. So if your traffic's high, test the button. If your traffic's low, test what got them to that. So that's kind of like testing up the funnel. Don't necessarily go for the conversion. You have to have the data to prove that with analytics. Testing shared elements, probably cruising through this one. Testing shared elements is that menu, amazing. The reason that worked and got us a data set so quickly was because every single page except for checkout had that menu on it, which means we had a lot of people visiting it and a lot of statistical data coming in. Who has used Hotjar or Crazy Egg? Yeah, if you don't know these sites, bookmark them, they're really awesome. They give you heat maps. They will show you what happens when a person clicks on your site, what they're clicking on, what they're hovering on, their mouse movement, so you get an idea of what they're clicking on and not clicking on. If you've got a button that no one's clicking on, but they're clicking on something up high and you really want them down low, use an A/B test to figure out if you should change or reduce the importance of the thing they're clicking on that doesn't convert, and get them down to the thing you want to do. So use those heat maps and those services of Hotjar and Crazy Egg to provide you a feature. Some other tests you can run. Button colors are like the simplest. Honestly, it's like an emotional thing. Red versus green versus blue versus purple. There's like this color chart that tells you what each color means, trust versus like stopping. Font sizes, we didn't realize this was gonna be a big one. We tested the font size on our hero image, and it made a huge difference. It was insane, like how many people actually clicked down below just from changing the font size. Your content width. How many people put thought into how wide your, whether it's blog post content or your checkout width or anything like that? Yeah, these ones surprise us. The checkout width was a statistical winner within like, I think like within a month. We made it skinnier. Yes, it made it taller, but we made it like, skinnier on the page and it converted better. What's up? Yeah. Yeah, it's surprising to me because I'm like, no, it's going to make it look long, they're going to have to scroll, it's going to convert worse, did better. We were reading an article about someone who did the test and we're like, we should try that. I mean, what's it going to hurt? We run it for a while and realize it doesn't work, then we go back. That's the other thing, mileage will vary. Just because I run an A/B test that works for me does not mean it's going to work for your site. So be sure that you test things, even though people say, oh, it totally worked for me. we've got this one thing we've been running for a while. It's not in an A/B test. It's in our plugin. That another plugin author that we were friends with did this one thing, and it converted amazing for them. Like, brought their monthly recurring up like $10,000 a month. And we're like, yeah, I want that. We did it, and it really hasn't done anything. So your audience will change. Even though we're both plugins, we both have kind of like the same ecosystem, it didn't work as well for us. So keep that in mind when you're doing this. Your menu order, I mean, that's like a simple one. It's on every page, most pages. And just changing the order can help them convert it. Call to action text, test the literal text, sign up now, purchase now, subscribe, which one works better? That was a big one for us too. We went from sign up to subscribe. And then we tested one that didn't have a subscription to purchase or buy now. It made a big difference. I thought about these as I was sitting over there earlier. Did you know that MailChimp can A/B test your emails? You can literally set up an A/B test in your mailing list. And then other services do this too. What was the other one I was thinking about? Oh yeah, who uses cart recovery, whether it's Carthook or Jilt or something like that, abandoned cart recovery. Yeah, if you're not doing it, do it. Jilt has a free plan. I think Carthook has a charge. I think they got rid of their like pay as you recover. But basically, if someone goes to your checkout, enters their email address, it puts them in a queue and says, hey, you forgot something in your cart. And we've all seen it, right? You can A/B test those through some of the services. A/B test everything you can. And find out what's working for your customers. I mentioned earlier that we chose a goal of target URL. Picking the proper goal isn't just revenue. Especially when you're dealing with call to actions or trying to go through a click funnel to get to an end result. Your goal of the test shouldn't always be revenue. It may be the number of transactions you took. It may be the average order size. I can increase revenue by $1,000 for 100,000 visitors. But if I increase revenue by 50 cents per order across 100,000 people, it adds up quickly. So like statistically, earning 25 cents, 50 cents, a dollar more per cart versus increasing my revenue by $1,000, I'll take a $100,000 increase at a dollar per cart all day. So make sure you're focusing on the right goal. Revenue per session is an interesting one. Are you converting more people? Are you getting more traffic? Clicks on a specific button, how many people complete your click, your purchase funnel or your sign up funnel. There's a really interesting, have you seen One Gary Glenn Ross? It's an old like stock market movie. I love that movie. They use a term called ABC, which is always be closing. You're always closing a sale. Whether or not you sell someone stock or they sell you on a reason why they can't. So someone is always sold at some point. I think that part comes from Boiler Room, which is a movie box. So. In A/B testing, we have ABT, which is always be tested. If you're not running a test, you're not trying to improve yourself. So trying to find something to test all the time, one at a time, not five tests on the same page. One quick mention is, I mentioned A/B testing a lot. There's also multivariate testing, which can get a little more complex to get results, but it's testing not just control versus one, but control versus two or three. So you can run three tests at once, split your traffic, 33.33 repeating across the board. So that's about 30 minutes. Let's do some questions if you have any services, anything like that you want to know about.
I have just started to use Facebook advertisements.
Okay.
And they have this A/B test inbuilt. Any suggestions or advice when I use that? Because I don't know how reliable is that.
All right, so the question is Facebook's A/B testing.
Yeah.
I have not personally used it. We actually use a service called Perfect Audience to do our Facebook advertising. They kind of do the bias for us. I know a couple of people who've used it. I don't know what their true statistics are on it. I would say, at a minimum, it's better than running a single ad. I mean, running any A/B testing is better than running no A/B testing. I'm gonna guess, I mean, Facebook A/B tests all the time. You don't realize it. You know, this is a great one. My favorite A/B tester is Netflix. They A/B test the covers of the movies or the TV shows. My favorite, who watched Stranger Things? Yeah, right? So my kids love Ghostbusters, and they watch the old, the real Ghostbusters cartoon that's horribly, like, audio's bad, the graphics are bad, and it's amazing to them. As my kids started accidentally watching the real Ghostbusters on my Netflix profile, the Stranger Things cover changed to the one of them wearing the Ghostbusters costumes. Right, genius. And they wrote a great blog post about the A-B test. They A-B test everything. So, yeah, you'll notice it. You don't think about it, but start using these services day in and day out, and you're gonna start seeing their A-B tests on you. And you're gonna be like, those sneaky little, they got me. I clicked on it right away, I was like, cool. That's a good question. What do we use for our A/B testing? So we used to use a service called Optimizely. It's kind of one of the older platforms for A/B testing, but they changed their pricing and it got extremely expensive. I know I worked at a large company that also used it, so that's where I knew it from. We currently use a product called Google Optimize. Google Optimize, there's a free tier that lets you run 5 tests at a time. If you pay for it, you can run more tests. But it integrates with your Google Analytics. So as long as you're running Google Analytics, you can drop one snippet of code on your website as well, like another little JavaScript thing, and it will run the Optimize. It's a WYSIWYG editor. You don't have to know any code. You can literally, if you know CSS or click and drag and drop, you can go into, you say, okay, Google Optimize, I want to modify this page. And it's like, all right, cool, here's a little WYSIWYG editor of your page. What do you want to change? You can change text, you can change the color of buttons, you can just remove an element. And it lets you kind of do all that from a WYSIWYG, you hit save, and then when someone loads the page that's in a test, it just flips whether they're in the control group or the variation. And then it imports all the data from Google Analytics on revenue, transactions, click-throughs, things like that. So yeah, as long as you have running e-commerce and you have Google Analytics, enhanced e-commerce data going to Google Analytics and you're running Optimize, it's all kind of one platform. You can use Monster Insights with their e-commerce add-on integrates with Google Optimize, Google Optimize. Or you can literally just copy and paste the scripts in. Yep. That's a good question. I know Crazy Egg also does A/B testing and kind of the same format.
The one you said, sorry, for Google is a lot. Google's actually displaying the variant then, because you said prevents like the WYSIWYG.
Yeah, so it gives you the WYSIWYG, and then you have the drop down of control and variation. So variant A, variant B. They call your control variant A.
So that's interesting. You don't have to make a change to your website.
Right, yeah.
To Google.
Correct.
And so you don't need any new technology or anything.
Nope.
You install this script.
Yep.
Google's going to control everything.
Yeah, so what they end up doing is when your page loads, before they present the document, the web page, they look at your test, look what group the person's in, and then make a modification on the fly before it pipes all the website to the user, so that they get the test. They basically modify the markup as it gets to the browser.
Does this affect speed?
I can. So there's two things about it. They have a delay system in place, so you can have a delay for like X milliseconds. They recommend like 400 milliseconds. You can cut it down to like 200 and we haven't seen any impact. Yeah, it does affect speed, but at the end of the day, like, I would rather know what the first button has a little 200 milliseconds. And then the beauty is you're only running it for the test. As soon as you're done with that and there's no test running, they will just speed things up.
But if it is affecting the speed of the variant and not the speed of the other, doesn't that make the result?
No, because it's when a variant's running, when it's running, it does it for both.
Oh, okay.
Because it has to pick whether the person visiting is in group A or group B before it displays it.
Oh, okay.
So and it's cookie, so like you can be like, nope, I'm in group A or group B.
Got it.
And there's a button that says go visit and view this variant, and it sets a cookie for you as the site owner and says go view this variation. It's really kind of cool. And that's the same with Optimizely. Optimizely adds a little delay because it's all loaded via JavaScript. So any A/B testing platform that you're doing that's using JavaScript is going to add a slight delay in to choose whether the person's in what group. Yeah, it's a good question, though. There is a slight delay. I won't say it's negligible. Is that what you were going to ask? Speed? I mean, clearly it hasn't affected us too much. I mean, we doubled revenue with one change. And I was like, yeah, cool, I can go home for the day.
Do you just leave Google to assign the variant afterwards? Like, it picks the winner and then you just
like Google?
No, we don't. We do for a short time. So what we'll do is once we have a winner, we feel like, all right, 100% goes to the very end that won. And then what we actually do is we'll make a change on our website, make it hard-coded, and then we turn off the test. Yeah, but definitely, you want to make sure you get it hard-coded. Right. Yeah.
Let's say you're testing something on the site, and then you make a change to your site's code, and install a plugin, or your developer, and you name something. What happens if the test can't be run?
It doesn't do anything. It focuses on, like, it's all CSS-based, so you're choosing IDs or classes to make a decision. And it's very specific. It's like this specific item with this class. It's not like all with this. You can make it say every item with this class is this color, or you can say just this item with this class is this color.
So you've never seen any testing break the site?
I haven't, no. I'm sure there's a way you can. I mean, you can break anything on the internet. Try hard enough and leave yourself. There was one thing I was going to mention that just made me think about it. They'll come back to me when I'm sitting in bed. Yeah?
How often do you think you should run A/B testing on a website?
How often should be A/B testing? All the time. Find something to test. I would say that it's better to know that you're right with your current website and with your current decisions than it is to be missing out on revenue that you should be getting, the conversions you should be getting. You know, like the menu change. That site, that redesign, sat there for 6.5 months before one day I was randomly looking at my website, at our website doing something. I was like, oh, I got to get to the downloads thing. Why don't I go up here? I'm like, people don't realize they have to click on this. They hover it and a menu pops up. Maybe they don't know that that's clickable. We should make something that just shows in the menu for them. And, so yeah, I would say find something to test somewhere all the time. I would say you could probably run menu tests, like something with your menu and page elements at the same time because they don't really affect each other too much. But test page elements, test wording. You know, our homepage, we tested the hero wording, not just the font size or the color or anything, but like just the way the words are phrased. An important thing, it will not affect SEO. Google detects search bots and gives them the control every time. So they kind of throw that in your code. So search, like Google crawling your website isn't going to affect your conversion rates or your lead stats. They basically throw that out and always look at a non variation. Yeah.
Is there a minimum, like you talk about the 5% rule, but is there a minimum amount of traffic you have to do to get it?
Google will pick it until a statistical winner. They don't have it. Some people say 1,000, I'm like, that's way too few. I can skew data pretty well with 1,000 users depending on how I look at it. Most of our tests run between, I think I was looking back at it while I was doing this talk. Most of our tests run between 20 and 30,000 visitors before it picks a winner. Now, again, it's not just using the number of visitors to say, like, all right, we took 30,000, we're going to pick a winner. But that's about the rough estimate. We take about 30,000 visitors before it picks a winner, roughly. But we can't. So, be ready for the long haul. And I think another important thing really quick I'll mention, we have a lot of people who write into our support saying, I need to make my checkout convert better. I'm just not converting. I'm not getting sales. I need to make my checkout better. How can I modify this thing in the checkout? And I'll go to their site and I'm like, problem is not your checkout. Problem is you do a crappy job of selling products. If you're not converting people, don't assume it's your checkout. Don't assume it's like the form's not built correctly or the checkbox for the privacy policy needs to go away. Like, those things probably aren't the problem. Traffic is your problem. Before you focus on A/B testing, make sure you're getting a significant amount of traffic. And I'm not saying it has to be hundreds of thousands of millions of visitors, but if you run A/B testing and all you're getting is 1,000 visitors a month, you're never going to get a statistical significant winner. So A/B testing may not be your first point. If you need to increase traffic, you need traffic, not A/B testing. That's probably my biggest point. Any other questions? I'm going to hang out with it so we can jam one-on-one. I could talk about this all day.
With the Google Optimize, are you able to see statistics? So if there isn't a statistic relevance presented by Google, you can choose your own decision if you want.
Yeah, absolutely. It'll give you, it still tells you all the goals. You pick three goals every single time you make a test and optimize. And based off those three goals, you can look at all the data later. So I think with the continue shopping, we got no statistical significance. We're like, no, let's keep it. It didn't really prove to hurt anything, and the off chance that we get three more conversions at $500, we just made up a revenue. So yeah, I would say if there's no statistical significance, go with the one that's most on brand and that you think may help you. But being on brand is key. Cool. Well, I appreciate you guys letting me come here and talk.